Chapter 3. Faith is a Mustard Seed. Jesus said, "To what shall we liken the kingdom of God? Or with what parable shall we picture it? It is like a mustard seed, which, when it is sown on the ground, is smaller than all the seeds on the earth. But when it is sown, it grows up and becomes greater than all the herbs, and shoots out large branches, so that all the birds of the air may nest under its shade." Mark 4:30-32. When we have faith so small it seems insignificant, God can grow it into something sturdy and supportive, something that even others can nest in. In Matthew 17:20, Jesus again said, "For assuredly I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, 'Move from here to there,' and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you." One of my daily devotionals, Streams in the Desert, by L.B. Cowman, has an entry by an unknown author named C.H.P. He talks about a passage written by Paul in the book of Galatians. "Before this faith came, we were held prisoners, locked up until faith should be revealed." Galatians 3:23. We are set aside for a time to learn a more excellent way of faith. Moses, Joseph, Paul, and Silas, even John, all learned about being put aside for a season, locked up to faith. Commit your circumstances to God. Praise Him, claiming Romans 8:28, that He will work all things for good to those who love Him and are the called according to His purpose. In Isaiah 64:4, God acts on behalf of those who wait for Him. Others will receive insight and blessings because you were locked up to learn the way of faith. Hebrews 11 has been called the faith chapter. In Hebrews 11:3, Paul writes, "By faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which are visible." We can frame our husband with the word of God by speaking into existence his salvation. God's word will not return void. Isaiah 46:11 states, "Indeed, I have spoken it, I will also bring it to pass. I have purposed it, I will also do it." 2 Corinthians 1:20 states, "For all the promises of God in Him are yes, and in Him amen, to the glory of God through us." That means so be it. God doesn't promise and fall through. I personally speak varied scriptures for salvation over my husband daily. One of my favorite scriptures is Romans 10:20, where Paul quotes a passage from Isaiah 65:1. "I was found by those who did not seek me. I was made manifest to those who did not ask for me." That gives me great hope that though my husband isn't looking, God can find him and show himself at any time to him. I believe God will move heaven and earth to accomplish this task, wooing them by His Spirit. Zechariah 4:6. It is God's job to make that call of salvation, and we must pray they hear the knock. Jesus says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and dine with him, and he with me." Revelation 3:20. I prayed, "Lord, let him have ears to hear your knock." Again in Matthew 19:26, Jesus says, "With men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible." The book of the prophet Ezekiel speaks of the things that should be hereafter, and has a great similarity to the book of Revelation by the Apostle John. One passage in chapter 37 depicts the valley of dry bones, in which God tells the prophet to prophesy to the disjointed and dispersed bones. God miraculously brought the bones to life, joining them with sinews and flesh and skin. Afterwards, God breathed the breath of life into them, and they became an exceedingly great army. God can surely breathe the breath of life into your husband. We need to prophesy every time we pray that God will raise him up. Salvation is a resurrection to the dead flesh of the world. Call him forth by name and believe that God hears your cry. You need both prayer and the Word of God to bring it to pass. It is God's grace that brings it into being. God will not only bring the bones to life, he will fashion them into a God-ordained man ready for service. As Ezekiel realized, God is the master of the impossible. Be ready to accept the improbable and expect God to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think. Ephesians 3:20. I am the first to heed the call of salvation in my family, but not the last. Psalm 68:6 states, God sets a solitary one in a family. I will stand in the gap for my unsaved loved ones and claim their lives for Christ. What a privilege it is to carry them to the throne of grace and petition God on their behalf. You'd better take seriously the holy charge that has been placed on you. You may be the only gospel they see and hear. The Apostle Peter states in 1 Peter 3:15, But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you, with meekness and fear. Your deep, abiding joy, regardless of circumstances, is a magnet to those around you who don't yet know the Lord. Remember, we walk by faith. 2 Corinthians 5:7. Not what we see, not what we hear, not what we feel, and not what we think. In Luke 8:48, Jesus says, Daughter, be of good cheer. Your faith has made you well. Go in peace. We need to be cured of our unbelief.
It is God's reputation on the line, not yours. Just believe.